So thank you very much for joining us today. And thank you, Dr. Bookbinder, for coming. We do look forward to your talk.
Well, hello to all of you, and thank you so much for, first of all, for coming today, but also for participating through this 10-week program of deeper looking into the issues involved in conjunction with the exhibition of drawings by Gustav Klimt and Christian Schad. And today we're going to hopefully embark on a ride through the 20th century, through about 100 years of art that has transpired since the time of Klimt and Schiele, not to have a survey, of course, of the art, but rather to look at ways in which artists in subsequent decades from the early years of the 20th century have built on the foundations that Schiele and Klimt established early in the century. And I want us to start out, in a sense, looking at more or less, almost random, but not quite, works, one by Gustav Klimt, Death and Life, as it's called, and one by Egon Schiele, a drawing of Klimt, in fact, in his blue painter's smock. And as I often say to my students, basically, the visual arts are about two things, what I sometimes call the what and the how for my students, and getting them to stay focused on those question terms. Their artworks have these two characteristics of what and how. That is, what in the sense of the content of the work of art. What is it about? What is the message in the work of art, if there is one? Sometimes it's a little hard to fathom that message. Sometimes it's very obvious. And the other, the how, which is the form that the artist uses, things like lines and shapes and colors or textures or materials or whatever is involved to communicate the what, assuming that the what is something different from the how. And we don't have to go there. And I don't mean to make your eyes glaze over before we really even get started. But at any rate, this question or this point about content and form is something I think we need to have in mind, because to my mind, Schiele and Klimt pushed new ideas in their work in ways of forcing the viewer, getting the viewer, inviting the viewer to contemplate the question of new thoughts on content and new thoughts on form. So if we look at Gustav Klimt's Death and Life, for example, we notice right away that the figures in the work are meant to stand for abstractions. They're not just figures of particular people in a representational space, but of course they are symbols, and symbolism is very important in particularly Klimt and Schiele's work. So we can see a symbol of a figure that's supposed to represent death. We see life in the form of figures representing motherhood and infancy and young couple and old age. So we have figures that are really symbols, and we know that Klimt is talking about some major ideas. On the other hand, if we look at Schiele's drawing of Gustav Klimt, who was his mentor in many ways, we know that, yes, we are seeing something of a likeness of the person, Gustav Klimt, but mostly what we're drawn to is the beauty and the movement of lines that Schiele is using. So it is the form of this drawing, its use of straight, angular lines, particularly if we look at the gesture of Klimt's, of the figure's hands, we see a very angular, tense, and meaningful, emotional message in those lines. So form is very important in Schiele's drawing. Content is very important in Klimt's painting of death and life. And we're going to see how the ideas that they've established early in the century, in the 20th century, percolate into the work of other artists. First of all, the first artist we have to certainly look at, and perhaps you've already been introduced to the work of Oskar Kokoschka, because he was a contemporary, certainly a contemporary of Schiele's, though a little younger than Klimt. Kokoschka's working on the scene at the same time as Klimt and Schiele are making the drawings that were in the exhibition that you've certainly seen. And if we look at this lithograph from actually a book of poetry that Kokoschka created, we can see in the elongated forms of these two figures, we can see in the angularity of their limbs, the horizontal, vertical, and diagonal lines that dominate in those figures, the tension in those figures. We certainly can see parallels with the form of Schiele's drawing that we began with. And of course, it's convenient here that this work was, as indicated in the note, that Kokoschka dedicated this work with respect, dedicated with respect to Gustav Klimt, because Kokoschka was acknowledging the importance of Klimt in the development of his own work. And this work, The Dreaming Youth, series of poems, in fact, is filled with the kind of symbolism and references to life, death, love, innocence, all of these ideas that Klimt often referred to. So again, we can look at a work by Gustav Klimt, for example, The Three Ages of Woman of 1905, and see again that Klimt is using figures in a metaphoric way to get at the idea of the passing of time. And or we can look at Schiele's drawing of a female nude with arms raised, and again see the form that it takes in its angularity, its elongated form, and know that Kokoschka is building on the work that both Klimt and Schiele were doing. Of course, Kokoschka himself is well known for his extravagant use of line, often writhing, twisting lines and forms to express powerful emotions. Again, for those of you who frequently come to the museum, you may be aware of this work in the MFA's permanent collection, and I love Kokoschka's commentary on this head, which is called Head of a Warrior, and so it's really interesting that Kokoschka calls it that, because it's also a portrait, self-portrait, and so we can see his own sense of agony and struggle, so characteristic of, well, both Schiele and Klimt's experience in the early decades of the 20th century. As he says, my exhibit space became the cabinet of horrors for the Viennese spectators when this work was put on display. My work, the object of people's scorn, everyday pieces of chocolate or something else were in my bust's wide open mouth, by which I assume girls expressed their additional scorn for the savage chief. So Kokoschka always feeling anxious and uneasy, certainly in ways similar to, for example, his colleague Schiele. So if we look at Schiele's self-portrait of 1912 and compare it with Oskar Kokoschka's self-portrait of the same period, we can see both of them exaggerating the outline of the figures and the stare of the eyes communicating such powerful emotional content. And another factor that we'll see so strongly presented in Schiele's work, and that is the use of hand gestures, is also a characteristic of this work by Kokoschka and is true of so many of the other works that Kokoschka would create, where, of course, we know that Schiele and Klimt passed away in 1918, died in 1918 as a result of the spread of Spanish influenza, which was, as it was called, which was so devastating at the end of World War I. Kokoschka continued to live for decades to come, and so the impact of Schiele and Klimt's early work has a long impact, effect on Kokoschka's work over subsequent decades. But in these two works, posters in both cases, well, actually a cover of a journal in the case of Kokoschka's work, and in a poster in the case of Egon Schiele's advertisement of an exhibition in 1915, we can see both artists seeing themselves as victims, as martyrs in, for them, of course, in the cause of art, and often feeling perhaps misunderstood or underappreciated, very consistent trope for artists in the 20th century, because I think because artists like these pushed, as we say today, pushed the envelope, really extended the possibilities of art to such an extent that they often met with certainly confusion, if not downright ridicule or objection from many people. And so they often thought of themselves as victims or martyrs to the cause of their work. And so we can see in both cases, in Kokoschka's work and in Schiele's, again, the form, the angularity, and tension in these works, as well as the use of a strong line, and at the same time, also the content of emotional pressure and uncertainty that both of them refer to. The cover of Der Sturm, as you see, is also brings us to the work, or at least the image, of a person who was very important in Kokoschka's development throughout the first and second decade of the century, and that was Herwarth Walden. Herwarth Walden, who's depicted in this portrait to the right, was the publisher of Der Sturm, meaning the storm. It's a was an avant-garde journal that published prints, drawings by prominent avant-garde artists, visual artists like Kokoschka, but also the writings of avant-garde writers. So it was a general arts magazine. And so at the same time that Kokoschka's self-portrait is on the cover, we can see in the portrait that Kokoschka did of the publisher, Herwarth Walden, first publisher of Der Sturm, we can see again those telltale characteristics of form, in particular the sharpness of angles, the tightness of the way Walden's hand is depicted, the veins that seem to be almost exploding on his face as lines, as angles moving throughout the surface, over the surface of his skin, and we can see those same angular lines in the exaggerated wrinkles and folds of his coat in the sharp light-dark contrasts that are used. So in all these ways, Kokoschka is taking some of those major formal ideas that we saw in Schiele's work and carrying them forward in this portrait of Herwarth Walden. As I indicated in the caption, Walden was also the publisher of a play that Kokoschka wrote called Murderer, Hope of Women. And you can think about just that title alone a little bit for a while, or you can think about it for a long time, in fact. And these are two of the drawings that Kokoschka produced as illustrations to go with the text of the play. The play was actually produced, I think, once. And the result of the play was basically your ordinary riot in the cafe where it was put on in Vienna, and a division of soldiers ended up in a battle with police and actors, and it was just a complete catastrophe. So the play was, as I said, was basically put on one time until in art settings in later decades when cooler heads have prevailed, it's been put on with certain reservations. But originally, it caused a catastrophe. So, and I think you can see, in fact, if you look at these drawings, that they've taken the angularities and tensions of Klimt and Schiele's drawings and turned them into, that Kokoschka has taken those drawings and turned those ideas into far more violent and aggressive representations, externalized representations of aggression and tension and conflict, as though externalizing those feelings in lines, angular lines on the outsides of the figures that he depicts. So Kokoschka really sort of ginned up the discussion and raised the temperature of the discourse about using form to capture the characteristics of the society and the tensions involved far beyond where Schiele or Klimt might have taken them. Of course, we don't know, since within the next decade they were no longer on the scene. But if we look here at at Kokoschka's portrait of a prominent and very successful architect of the day, Adolf Loos, and we compare Kokoschka's painting of Adolf Loos to a contemporary photo of Adolf Loos from, by the way, that was included as, I think, a frontispiece in a book that Adolf Loos wrote, which was called Ornament and Crime. I mean, that tells you this guy was really doctrinaire. Very, very strong views on architecture. And basically, he considered any ornament on any building to be subject to criminal prosecution. So he was very firm about that. And I think you can see in the way the photo looks, that this guy looks like somebody you don't want to tangle with, and very sure and very confident in his manner. But if we look at Kokoschka's painting of Adolf Loos, we see somebody who seems like a jangle of nerves. Again, the angularity, the repeated diagonals, the tension of the clasped hands, the anxiety in the face, and Loos himself commented that this picture is a better likeness of me than I am myself. So obviously his photo shows him covering up a lot of deep-seated emotional content that Kokoschka reveals through those angular lines and the powerful contrast of light and dark, for example. And another work that Kokoschka did, a drawing of and portrait of the writer Karl Kraus, which he published, among other things, this journal called Die Fackel, which means the torch, as you can see. If we look at the drawing of Kraus and we look at the photo again of Karl Kraus, we can see, as Kokoschka himself Kraus himself states, Kokoschka has made a portrait of me. I love this statement. It is possible that those who know me will not recognize me, but certainly those who don't know me will. So in, obviously, for those of us who didn't know Karl Krauss personally, this drawing becomes what we know about Karl Krauss's inner feelings. And notice how Kokoschka presents, particularly Krauss's hands, that same kind of exaggerated angularity that we saw, for one, in Schiele's self-portrait, and we'll come in and see again in other images that Schiele produced in roughly that same time period. Kokoschka was commissioned in 1910 to do a portrait of a well-known scientist whose name was Auguste Forel. And Forel was a senior citizen at the time that the portrait was done. Kokoschka was commissioned by Forel's family to make this portrait of their very prominent professor, scientist, a very well-established person. So Kokoschka worked on the portrait for a while, had Forel sit for him many times, and at the end produced this portrait. When the family saw the portrait, they were aghast. And they said they refused to pay for it. They didn't want this portrait. They said, for goodness sake, you have made Professor Forel look like, you know, like he can't think straight, like he's just a jittery bunch of nerves and anxieties, and he's not like that at all, and we won't buy this portrait. And Kokoschka said, that's okay, I'm happy to keep it. And within about 6 months or thereabout of the completion of the portrait, poor Professor Forel had a stroke. And unfortunately, he ended up very much looking like Kokoschka's portrait. Kokoschka said, you can think what you want, but I saw what was coming. I saw Forel's spirit, and that's what I painted. So you can believe that or not, that's okay. But we can certainly see the amount of spirit that is in this portrait, if not at the time, the representational character that his family was expecting. If we look at this painting, Two Nudes by Kokoschka, this is also work in the MFA's collection, we at first might think, well, big deal, you know, it's two figures. This is a theme that's been done forever, certainly in the Western tradition for hundreds of years. And it seems as though, well, here are these figures in a generalized setting, strokes of blues and greens and violets in the background, and that's about it. But if we look again and we look closely at the two figures, we begin to notice something that's odd about them. If we look at the expressions on each of their faces, first of all, neither of them makes eye contact with the other. They're looking in different directions. Their bodies are moving in opposite directions. The angles of their limbs are set in opposition to one another, and we begin to say, something's going on here. Well, of course, these two figures, and again, perhaps you already know this, are Oskar Kokoschka and his then mistress, Alma Mahler. And if you just saw this painting, you'd say, oh, I don't know that I'd put money on this relationship continuing, and of course, you'd be absolutely right. And so we see Kokoschka, again, using form, the placement of the figures, the angular lines, the strong contrast of light and dark, the shadows that come and go, the turn of the heads, to convey a content which transcends representation and captures something of the spirit of the moment and the spirit of these two people. We can see that same play of forces in this work by Kokoschka, again, his self-portrait, again, with Alma Mahler in this painting, perhaps his most famous painting called The Tempest of 1914. And again, we can see that while Alma sleeps sort of oblivious to everything going on around her, even the swirling, almost whirlwind character of the atmosphere, we can see Oscar's head tense and exaggerated. We can see the sharp angular lines, the strong contrasts of light and dark, and the sense that something is going on, something that reveals not only their inner turmoil, but I always say to my students, look at the date. Look at the date of the painting. It's 1914. This is not a coincidence. It's 1914. It's the time of the outbreak of World War I. And times like that, even if not directly in the consciousness of an artist like Kokoschka, first of all, I think it was, but even if you put that aside, the sense of impending change, of anxiety about the onset of war, sometimes the exuberance, not in this case, but the exuberance about war, all of that certainly plays into the artist's unconscious and here percolates out in Kokoschka's painting, which he named The Tempest, even though we know that it's really about, in the immediate sense, about his own suspicions that the time of his relationship with Alma Mahler is coming to, that relationship is coming to an end. But it's interesting to see the similarities between that same painting and almost contemporary painting by Egon Schiele called Death and the Maiden. And as you can see, it's very similar composition. Colors are different, but the relationship of the figures, this painful grasping of a death by a struggling, emaciated young woman certainly suggests the same sense of anxiety characteristic of the age. At the same time, if we look at another painting by Egon Schiele, The Lovers of 1917, we can see again relationships clearly with Kokoschka's painting and the interplay of these figures clinging to each other less, seemingly perhaps initially in an erotic way, but in fact clinging in a sense of almost a struggle against death itself. And that's all part of the discourse that was very much in the air at that time. Another artist, far less known in Viennese circles at the time, known certainly much more for his music, was Arnold Schoenberg. Schoenberg is certainly best known as a composer and as the originator of the 12-tone style or way of composing that really set musical writing on its ear. Nobody had any idea initially how to deal with Schoenberg's innovative musical compositions, and he certainly was initially known for his music. What is less known is he was also an artist. So we're going to see, as we move beyond Schiele's drawing, watercolor drawing of Arnold Schoenberg, that Schoenberg used the same sort of not only innovative thinking, but imaginative approach in his paintings that he used in his music. And so I included this quotation from a letter that Schoenberg wrote to Vasily Kandinsky in 1911. As we look at Schoenberg's, it's called the Blue Self-Portrait, art belongs to the unconscious. One must express oneself directly. Art does not come from being able to create, but from having to create. So there's a sense of intensity and commitment and power that Schoenberg was communicating in his music, and that is also present in the glance, in the stare of the self-portrait. Now, this statement comes, as I said, from a letter he wrote to Kandinsky. Vasily Kandinsky had learned about Schoenberg's music because it was performed in a concert hall in Munich in late 1910 or 1911. And he hadn't gone to the concert, but friends of his, Franz Marc and others, had attended this concert and came away just blown away by Schoenberg's music. And they said to Kandinsky, "You got to meet this guy. I mean, his music is like something else." And then they learned that Schoenberg was also a painter. So here we see the start of something interesting that I want you to keep track of, and that is that both Kokoschka and Schoenberg were Viennese. They were part of the Vienna art scene, but they began to move out into other circles. And we'll see that Kokoschka, tell you that Kokoschka, of course, not only did he also traveled to Germany, and there was much back and forth about his work, but eventually he moved to London and then set up permanent residence in Switzerland, but he also visited, in fact, in Boston, and so many of his ideas came to Boston. Schoenberg, too, when he fled Germany, he went back to Austria, and then when he fled from Austria, first to Germany, and then traveled through Europe, and eventually ended up in the United States. He settled first in Boston before ending up in California, where he wrote scores for music for films in Hollywood. A little odd to think about, but that's what did happen. But in the meantime, so I want you to keep in the back of your mind the fact that these artists move around, and they're in contact across national lines. So here we see one of the most signature works of Arnold Schoenberg. He did a whole series called The Stare or The Gaze, and sometimes one term and sometimes another is used. This painting is called The Red Stare, and as you can see from the quotations, "I have never seen faces, but instead when I saw people, I saw only their gaze. Thus, I am able to reproduce this gaze in my depiction. A painter catches with a single glance the whole person, but I catch simply his soul." So this is very symbolic. This is, Schoenberg is thinking on a very, very metaphysical level. And then he goes on in another publication that he wrote. He says, "Artists often close their eyes in order to perceive what the physical senses cannot convey, to look at the inner workings of what only seems to appear externally." So he's really aiming for an inner sort of vision and a revelation of spirit or soul through the act of looking. And again, we can see connections to Schiele's, to so many of his self-portraits, with eyes that seem to look through us, not just at us. And of course, Schiele using gesture as well as a way of conveying some kind of inner mysterious signal. Now, I mentioned about artists traveling across borders and carrying their thoughts, their ideas with them. An artist who looks totally different, and his paintings are totally different, say, from either Kokoschka or Schoenberg, was Christian Schad. Now, Christian Schad, and if we look at this painting by Christian Schad on the left-hand side, I mean, what could be further than the paintings we've been looking at? This is true. Christian Schad was German, but he spent a year in Vienna and in the mid-1920s, 1926 or so, and was very aware of the work of Klimt, in particular Schiele, Kokoschka, and maybe Schoenberg, probably less in the case of Schoenberg. But at any rate, Schad took from the art that he saw in Vienna less, perhaps, some of the, what seemed like, less of the intensity and more of the style of, say, of Klimt, as Klimt presents it in this portrait of Emily Flöge. And certainly we can see in the similarity of the glamorous pose, the gorgeous costumes, dress that Emily Flöge is wearing, the costumes of the models posed with the portrait, in Schad's portrait of Count Saint-Genois d'Annecourt. We can see that certainly the linearity is there. We can see the edges very clearly, not so much just lines, but edges that are very striking. But surely we can see this superficial elegance. However, there's something off about the portrait, the Christian Schad portrait. And if we look at it closely, we can see that the figure of Count Saint-Genois d'Annecourt, first of all, has a very worried, uneasy expression on his face. His figure seems pushed in between these two Amazon women. And in fact, what becomes clear is that we're not even sure that they're in the same space. Are those two women perhaps on a great big canvas, painted on a canvas, and the Count is standing in front of that? Or are they in fact in the same space and he's being overwhelmed by this almost vulture-like woman who seems to be peering over his shoulder? So even in the case of Christian Schad, whose work seems thoroughly focused on material representation, we sense an underlying quality of tension, anxiety, unease, strangeness that percolates through his work. It's there in this wonderful portrait on the left of this woman. Her name is Sonia. There she is. However, the painting has a strange name. It's called Max Hermann Neisse in the background. That's the name of the painting. So in spite of the fact that Schad gives us this very representational appearance of this elegant woman, notice how her form is also sharply outlined, presented to us very distinctly, so the form is very clear. But then we look at this figure in the upper left corner. We can barely see much of him except that his head is kind of, he doesn't seem to have much of a neck, his head is pushed in, his ear is sort of strange, and guess what? That happens to be Max Hermann Neisse. He was a writer, a poet, well-known in culture circles, both in Vienna and in Berlin, which is where Schad generally was when he wasn't in Vienna. And so there is this well-known person seemingly pushing in and set behind the figure of Sonia, whose last name we don't have, who seems to occupy the majority of the painting. Again, it raises more questions than it answers. It gives us this uneasy, the painting gives us this uneasy feeling. And that same idea is carried through in another German artist of the period, Otto Dix, whose work becomes even more, even more strongly present both in terms of the use of representation, but again, that sense of exaggerated angularity. And so if we look at Dix's portrait of the journalist Sylvia van Harden, we can see, as with Sonia, this superficially very elegant, elongated figures, very long, the hands occupy very powerful, prominent place. The movement and tension in the head is very strong, and while she seems relaxed and everything's cool, at the same time, we have a sense of underlying tensions in the figure. The same thing we saw in Schiele's self-portrait and conveyed also in Otto Dix's portrait of Alfred Flecktime. Alfred Flecktime's well-known art dealer in Berlin in the 1920s, and he, as we saw in Christian Schad's portrait of Count Saint-Genois, with the figures in the background, that here for Otto Dix, Flecktime takes on almost the appearance of some kind of predatory creature. He grasps a painting. The sleeve of his jacket is very angular, and the folds are very exaggerated. And he looks thoughtful, but also he looks almost like a predator about to pounce. One hand on the documentation of the painting with bills for it, and one hand on the work. He's a businessman, and that's what the sense of his intensity is very strong. This is one of Dix's best-known works called Big City Triptych, and we could spend a long time analyzing this painting. I don't want to do that, but what I do want you to notice that is surprising about it is its form, its overall format. It's what's called, in art historical terms, a triptych. But a triptych has a particular, function at least, and therefore meaning in earlier centuries. Triptyches, that is, a series of three separate canvases, sometimes not canvases, sometimes paintings on wood, would be hinged together so that they could, if you angle in the sides, you can have it standing somewhere. Usually and originally, that kind of format was used to place paintings on top of an altar in a church. So triptyches were, you could say, invented to serve a religious function. And for centuries, that is from the late Middle Ages through the 18th century, that's how they were used. But here, Otto Dix takes this religious format, associated with religious meaning, and instead he presents us with life of the modern city of the 1920s. We've got the roaring 20s in the middle section, all glitz and glamour, but in the side sections, we see what's going on in the alleys, not the speakeasy or nightclub in the center, the alleys, the dark places. And we see the results particularly of the end of World War I, of the years of struggle and depression in Germany in the post-World War I period. We see veterans with amputated limbs living in the shadows, reduced to begging in order to get by. And that's, for Dix, the modern world depicted in this religious format. So instead of having a religious scene meant to inspire and perhaps comfort people, instead he presents us with this very harsh depiction in metaphorical form of the modern age of the big city. Certainly the sense of death always being in the shadows is an important theme that we have seen in Klimt's work from the turn of the century. And here Dix presents it in these absolutely painful etchings from his series called War Series. We can see the presence of death in excruciating, painful, linear detail. So again, we have the linearity. Again, we have the metaphorical symbol of the skull, of the corpse of the sentry, and we have this discomforted sense or awareness of the omnipresence of death, even in life. Another artist who focused on the suffering in the same period in Germany during the 1920s and into the 30s was Kati Kollwitz. And Kollwitz was primarily an artist who worked in, who was known for her drawings, her lithographs, and for her sculpture. And there are many examples of her work in the MFA collection. This one is a particularly horrifying image, death and the mother. And so again, we see the references to the presence of death in life, of mother, child, and the form of the presence of death, just as we have that in, I have to say, of course, this is a bad photo of the original painting of that Gustav Klimt did for, as one of the panels in Vienna University. This panel, this painting doesn't exist anymore, and we're left with photos of it. But if we look at the upper right-hand section, we can see a pregnant woman figure way up in the corner, a figure of death, and death pushing in toward a figure of a child wrapped in a blanket as though gathering the child in. And again, that presence of metaphoric symbolist references are there, were there in Klimt, and we can see Kollwitz making reference to them as well, as she does in this, again, this connection. So death reaches for a group of children from the same period, again, has a similar take to Schiele's Death and the Maiden of a couple of decades earlier. The lines, I think, in this Kollwitz lithograph are also particularly expressive and convey that same sense of emaciated, elongated form and angularity that Schiele certainly championed. And we can see that in works of the contemporary to Kollwitz artist George Grosz, whose work transcends or covers the decades of the post-World War I period. Grosz, by the way, as I mentioned in the case of Schoenberg and Kokoschka, of course, is one of those artists who carries these ideas across boundaries, across national boundaries. And Grosz moves, leaves Germany, his home, in the 1930s, and brings his art and his understandings to the States and settles in New York, where he lived until around 1949. And we can see, though, in both of these works, these pen and ink and watercolor drawings, that he too starts with what seem like representational images of just folks on a street walking around. But if we look closely, we can see, as with Kokoschka's murderer hope of women, we can see all kinds of horrible, violent things going on in those, if we look inside the windows of Grosz's street scene. If we look at Dusk, the painting on the watercolor painting on the right, we can see not only just random people on the street, but people who are representations of different economic groups, the out-of-work worker or perhaps soldier who is begging, the aristocrat in his little hat and formal coat on the left, middle-class people in between, and everybody sort of eyeing one another. So there's a lot of tension and anxiety in society that grows, it makes us aware of. Probably the most powerful artist of this period, who takes some of those same characteristics and carries them first to great art in his native Germany, but then brings those characteristics to the US, was Max Beckmann. And Beckmann is very important to the transition, to the legacy of Schiele and Klimt, and bringing those ideas into the later decades of the 20th century, and in bringing those ideas to the US as well, and particularly, by the way, to Boston. So here we see a self-portrait that Beckmann did in his year as a medical orderly in 1915, as with, we don't have time to go into this, many of these artists initially volunteered for the army, either the German army or the Austro-Hungarian army for World War I, and ended up being either wounded or having nervous breakdowns or having to get out of the army within a year or so. So most of them did not last very long, those who survived at all. And Beckmann is one who really had an emotional collapse after a year as a medical orderly, witnessing time and again the bloodshed, of course, of war, being present in operating rooms over and over again, drawing figures pressed in, crowded together in operating rooms or sometimes in a morgue, and finally feeling as though he had to escape from that that reality. So he ends up in a hospital and ultimately is discharged from the army in a year or so. If we look at his self-portrait of 1917, we can self-portrait with red scarf, we can see many characteristics that compare to Schiele's self-portrait with black clay pot and spread fingers. We can see the use of angular gestures that sort of make our hands ache as we think about them, and the use of line to create a sense of tension throughout the work. Also in the case of Beckmann, this important characteristic of Beckmann's work, the figure seems as though it's too big for the space of the canvas. It's pushing out or it's being compressed in, and it seems tight in that space, a sense that again gives the viewer a feeling of discomfort. And that's very much characteristic of Beckmann's work, and it's there in particularly in Schiele's work. The portrait, self-portrait in tuxedo, is one of the most famous of Beckmann's self-portraits, and that one isn't in the MFA, but it's just across the river in Cambridge, so you can go visit it. It's a magnificent painting. And we can see some clear similarities, certainly to Christian Schad's painting of Count Saint-Genois in its seeming elegance and clarity, coolness. But we know, as we did with Schad, that there are underlying tensions and pressures that seem to be lurking, a sense of worry and ambivalence. And if we look at Beckmann's figure, not just for the what it tells us, but how it's painted, we can see not only furrowing of his brow and a tension in his jaw, we can see that, but we can see that there's kind of like a separation left and right of dark and light. It runs right down through his face, powerful light-dark contrasts. His arm, his right arm, is pushed in against the side of the canvas. Again, that sense of pressure and of being in a space that's too small for his big body. And if we look at the hand, left hand that is on our right side that is holding the cigarette, we can see the tension in his fingers, and we know that something's afoot, something's not quite right. And if we look at a still life painting from the same period, seems superficially like, what's the big deal, still life with candles, same year, but then we look again, and not only do we notice powerful black-white lines, zigzagging angular lines, but we notice that, wait a minute, these candlesticks have fallen over, and they're lit. And it's the sort of what is wrong with this picture. We know that within a short time, that drapery, that cloth, is going to catch on fire, and the whole thing is going to erupt in flame. And certainly Beckmann uses still life, just as he uses this cool self-portrait in a tuxedo, to give us a premonition that something bad is percolating under the surface. And of course, that something bad becomes the circumstances in Germany and Austria that developed during the 1930s that lead Beckmann to paint Departure, this triptych, notice the triptych form, and that's why I stressed that with Otto Dix's Big City triptych, this form that had been used for religious imagery here becomes a means of showing escape in the central panel of an open sea and sky that can take the king, the Fisher King, and his family away to a distant shore. But on the left and right sides, we see these horrible scenes of bondage and torture. Again, black angular lines, tight-fitting figures squeezed into tight spaces, and we sense the amount of tension and anxiety in them. This painting, another triptych that Beckmann did, so he did a number of triptychs that again pose the confrontation between a religious form, the triptych, and contemporary situation. He does it all using metaphorical languages. We don't see people who look like everyday ordinary people, but we do see in the center here of temptation, we see an artist who is looking at a model. And then it's a very traditional idea, but the artist is, his hands are tied. He's got this chain connecting to his wrist. He's tied, he's chained there. He looks at the model, but he can't paint or draw her because his hands are restricted. Furthermore, if you look right next to the canvas that he's holding at the side of the center panel, the left side, you notice there are flames, small flames rising. So as in the still life with candles, here too, a fire is starting to develop, a fire that the artist is helpless to stop, and a fire that ultimately threatens the whole project of the art that the artist makes. Again, the left and right panels are scenes of bondage and torture. And again, we have the sense of the need for departure. By the 1930s, Beckmann painted this painting in Holland, in Amsterdam, where he had sought refuge to get out of Germany. But he was stuck there for the entire war, and it wasn't until the post-war period that he could come to the U.S. He ended up teaching in St. Louis for a number of years, but during at Washington University in St. Louis. While he was there, though, he visited Boston on a number of occasions. The reason he visited Boston was because he had an old friend who had come to Boston to escape from the oncoming Nazi onslaught in Germany, and that was Karl Zerbe. Karl Zerbe was a young man at this time, younger than Beckmann, and he had come to Boston, although he had already had some success in Germany, but he knew the handwriting was on the wall and he had to leave. And he came to Boston where he first taught at the Cambridge Art Center, and then he got a job as the head of the painting department of the school, the School of Museum of Fine Arts, right across the street from here. And he worked at that school from the mid-1930s until 1950. And we could talk a lot about Zerbe. This is one of his paintings, Melancholia, on the left. And what do you know? First of all, although it's actually one canvas, it looks like a triptych. It's divided into three panels. It has many, many symbols in it that have to do with his sense of frustration and his sense of being an outsider. And how do I know that? Because if we look at the painting on the right, his self-portrait as Harlequin, we can see that the central two figures in the central panel of Melancholia, the triptych, are Harlequin figures. They're figures of a clown always seen as the the character laughing on the outside, crying on the inside, filled with a sense of underlying anxiety, and it's very strong in Zerba's work. He brought many new ideas to the museum school and really revolutionized what had been a very tradition, academically based kind of curriculum in painting, and really changed what was going on. And in fact, he was instrumental in having Beckmann, Max Beckmann, come to Boston to speak to museum school students and other painters in the area. And while Beckmann was visiting, Zerba painted this portrait of Max Beckmann on the left. And I show it to you with a very similar, though somewhat earlier, self-portrait that Beckmann did. Beckmann always presented himself as a powerful, I'm in charge kind of guy. And we can see that in his self-portrait with horn on the right. Zerba uses a very similar color scheme in his portrait of Max Beckmann. But instead of those straight, dark lines that Beckmann uses, Zerba turns them into sharp angles, thin, skinny lines that sort of move all over the surface, kind of like the way Kokoschka painted. And in fact, Zerba knew Kokoschka as well. We see in the expression on Zerba's Beckmann's face, and in the hand gesture, a sense of unease and tentativeness, very different from the way Beckmann presented himself. This painting by Zerba called Disorder is in the MFA collection, and it bears some connection to Beckmann's still life with candles. Again, superficially, it looks like your plain old sort of standard still life. But as we look at it again, we can see lots of things are out of order. Things are disjointed. Disorder is a good title for it. There's great clutter on this table. The table is broken. The base is cracked. It's part of the top of the table is also broken. It looks like those glasses are about to fall over. There's clutter on the table, representative images on the table, but seemingly discarded paintings, abstract paintings, on the lower part below the table. And Zerba seems to be really in a quandary about whether he's going to continue being what he had always been, which was a figurative artist. But during the mid-1940s, abstraction was becoming the new big thing. And instead of joining that bandwagon, Zerba wondered if sticking with representation and using the figure or objects to convey metaphorical messages would be something he would do. And he really struggled with that. And we can see that struggle in his work called Job, on the left, which is also a painting in the MFA collection. Again, we can see in its angularities, in its tensions, many of the characteristics, the struggle and the stare that Schiele gave us in his own self-portrait. One of Zerba's outstanding students was an artist whose name is David Aronson. David Aronson passed away, I think about couple months ago or so. Aronson was a student at the museum school, and he went on to be head of the art department, the painting department of Boston University, what was then called the School of Fine and Applied Arts. Now it's called the College of Fine Arts. So it's had a couple of different names. But at any rate, David Aronson was very important in carrying many of the ideas of people like Beckmann and Zerba through to the next generation of art students who he had contact with. And we can see in this painting called Christ Before Pilate, which is again at the MFA, we can see, look at those zigzagging lines and that pressed in space. I love the figure of the centurion, the guy with the helmet on the upper right, wearing, for reasons that I don't understand exactly, a bathing suit, a sort of a tracksuit or bathing suit. And if you look, the reason I'm showing to you with Beckmann's Temptation, if you look at the gladiator figure on the lower left of Beckmann's painting with the helmet, you can see how Aronson has taken that, the head of the gladiator, and turned it really into a joke, making the figure into a kind of scrawny old guy who supposedly is there to intimidate the figure of Jesus in the foreground, pushed in the foreground. Aronson struggled with a problem that most artists don't have and don't deal with. Aronson came from an Orthodox Jewish background. His family, he himself was born in Lithuania. Family came to Boston. They were very poor. His grandfather was a rabbi. And then the grandson decides he wants to be an artist. Oh my goodness. What that does is it violates, if you're an Orthodox Jew, to be an artist, to paint figures in particular, violate the second commandment. And there was the rub for Aronson. So Aronson was sort of the black sheep of his family. So what does he do? What does any 18-year-old rebel do, of course? Not only is he going to violate the second commandment according to Jewish Orthodox tradition, but he's going to paint Christian subjects. And so he does. So he really grabs the idea of symbolism, metaphor, and he runs with it. And so we can see the same forms, the angularities, the pressures, the intensity that we have seen from the early decade, the first decade of the century forward. We can see Aronson taking those same forms, applying those forms to little figures that seem to be nervously running around carrying out scenes from the Christian scriptures. And we can see that also in this painting on the left called Resurrection, where not only has Aronson taken Klimt's idea of the use of a dead figure and the metaphor of other figures in contrast, these little angel figures that seem to be carrying the figure of Jesus still in its shroud upward into the sky, but he also has taken the idea of death, and he's begun to think about death as a transforming experience. When he was working on this particular painting, Resurrection, Aronson decided, he needed to see real dead bodies. And he had a friend who got him a pass to go to a hospital that doesn't exist anymore called Kenmore Hospital in Kenmore Square to witness autopsies at the hospital so he could deal with seeing corpses and paint a corpse so that he could then paint the scene of resurrection. Before he went to the hospital, he ran into another young artist in Kenmore Square. He was on his way to the hospital. He ran into Hyman Bloom. And Hyman Bloom is also a young artist, also from Orthodox Jewish background, born in Lithuania, family had moved to Boston, and he was struggling to be an artist, Hyman was. And so Aronson asked Bloom if he wanted to go to the hospital and see some corpses. Bloom said, sure, went along, and made studies there of the autopsies, and he made studies of numerous corpses. And he became intrigued with the corpses, but not because they were dead bodies. Rather, he became intrigued with them because he saw in those corpses the beginning of a transformation, that just as the Aronson's painting of the resurrection speaks about metamorphosis and change and a renewal of life out of death, without getting quite so metaphorical. Bloom, too, thought about these corpses as the beginning of new life, not just of death. And so in these paintings, he paints the texture of the paint, the use of color, is in the hope of giving the viewer a feeling not of death, but of new life being generated out of this seeming end. Again, moving far beyond representation to something transcendent. And that's what's important about these paintings. Again, the figure, the female corpse back view is in the MFA. Bloom grew up with another artist in the area in Roxbury, right here in Boston, whose name was Jack Levine. Also, Jack Levine had been born here. He was the last child of a big family, all of whom had been born, lived in Latvia, I believe, before coming here. But they grew up in Roxbury, very poor, and the two of them very talented. These are two drawings they made, Levine's St. Jerome on the left and Bloom's Two Wrestlers on the right, 1930, as you can see, when each of them was 16 or 17 years old. So really talented draftsmen. They could draw beautifully. And so there's a whole long story about how they were discovered, but the point is that they went on to make works of very different character. And so here's a painting that, again, speaks of more than what it just seems to have as its subject matter. Street Scene, number one, another painting in the MFA collection by Levine, certainly picks up on the same pathos that Gros gave us in his watercolor called Dusk, of the poor in society, people who work hard and are usually ignored or passed over. And we can see that in the figures sitting outside of a cafe in Boston, on a Boston street, and there are buildings in the distance where if you look into what Boston looked like in the 1930s on the edge of where Roxbury begins to trail off toward Copley Square, you can recognize some of the buildings that are in Levine's painting. So he starts out with representation, but by exaggerating form, by emphasizing those linear characteristics I've been speaking about, we can see him turning these figures into symbols of their class, symbols of resignation and quiet restraint, and really taking the discussion to another level. If we look at at Levine's painting called Tombstone Cutter, certainly in its use of that nervous line over the surface, it's clear that Kokoschka's portrait of Auguste Forel, Auguste should have an E at the end of it, sorry about that, are very similar. So we can see Levine taking the traditions of Vienna and bringing them into the 1940s. Now we're going to look at an artist quickly whose work will be, I think, a real challenge. It doesn't look at all like anything we've seen. So why did she throw this in? Well, there are a number of reasons. In roughly 1968-69, an artist who was very much part of, you know, I mentioned how abstraction had come on and poor Carl Zerba was struggling with whether to stay with the old-fashioned kind of figuration or become an abstract painter and go in a different direction. Well, Philip Guston was a very successful ab-ex painter in the 1950s. Big deal. But as he said, in the 1960s, he would read magazine articles or newspaper articles or watch something on television. What he was referring to were stories about the civil rights movement, stories about the war in Vietnam. And he said, I go into a fury about these stories I read and then go into my studio and try to adjust a red to a blue, meaning to paint abstractly. And he felt as though he was ignoring the real questions of his time, the issues of the day. And he felt so guilty about it that he transformed his painting entirely. So if we look at the painting called The Studio on the left, it's not just a weird cartoony painting of a guy in a KKK hood smoking a cigar and, of all things, painting a self-portrait because he's painting a guy in a hood on his canvas. But what it is a self-portrait of Gustin. Gustin is seeing himself as the KKK guy. And we can see in this other painting of roughly the same time called Dawn, we can see here in this cartoony scene these two KKK hooded people in a rounded cartoony car, but with bodies sticking out of the back, legs meaning corpses, sticking out of the back, returning from a night of fun, I guess. And so we see Gustin identifying this way. Is he revealing that he was a member of the KKK? No, is the answer to that question at all. But he is identifying with the sense of guilt and pain as somebody who had ignored situations that he should have been taking a stand on. That's what he is saying. And if we look at this painting called Studio Landscape, painted a couple of years later, now he's painting something that is recognizable as a human figure. And by the way, the thing with the cigar and the cigarette is very specific. Not only does it kind of allude to what we saw in Beckmann using the cigarette as a sign of sophistication, but here, the thing about Gustin is he was a chain smoker and proud of it. Yeah. Guess what? He died much earlier than he should have of a heart attack. That'll come as a bit shock, I'm sure. Anyway, but you see, so every time you see a figure with a cigarette out of its mouth, you know, Gustin's talking about himself. And there he is in his studio, and one would think he was painting, but he's not. His hand has turned into this pockmarked claw, almost, of some kind of creature on the right-hand side. And in his hand, instead of holding a paintbrush, he's holding the end of, it's called a cat of nine tails. It's like a whip used to lash prisoners. It's a kind of torture instrument. And that's what he's got in his hand. So that sense of guilt is carried through metaphor into his work. In these late paintings done very shortly before he passed away, again, I wish we had time to talk about them, but again, we can allude to the fact, to IB on the left, IB stood was a short term, it was initials, of a Russian journalist and writer whose name was Isaac Babel. And Isaac Babel rode with the Cossacks, to write a story about the Cossacks, he rode with the Cossacks in Russia as they went and committed pogroms throughout southern Russia, particularly in the area of Odessa. Gustin's family came from Odessa when they migrated to the U.S., immigrated to the U.S., and the thing about Babel writing about the Cossacks is that in order to ride with the Cossacks, Babel did not acknowledge the fact that he himself was Jewish. The thing about Gustin and the guilt that he was feeling had to do with the fact that he had changed his name. His name was Philip Goldstein. And he changed his name when he came to New York from California to be a painter. He changed his name because he thought he'd be more successful if his name weren't obviously Jewish. And so he had, in his mind, sort of rejected his own identity. And that was the guilt that really underlay so much of his actions. So we have an artist working out his guilt through using symbolic, metaphorical language. And in one of the last paintings Gustin did, called Untitled, that's helpful, we see that hand holding the cigarette seemingly, we would assume, okay, that's Guston's hand, and he's working at this mound of paint, perhaps on a palette, to create a painting. But on the other hand, the proportions are so bizarre, the scale is so weird, it almost could be the hand of God creating on a landscape, working, coming down, but also with a cigarette between his fingers, so whatever that means. I want to finish with a couple of photographs that bring us full circle back to Vienna in 2015. On the left is one of these photos by a Viennese photographer whose name is Inga Preda, and she did a series of photo sets with live models posing in certain ways to do with images that, guess what, Gustav Klimt had made roughly around the turn of the 20th century, so over 100 years before. First of all, I want to thank the visual resources curator at Boston College, Andrea Frank, for calling my attention to these images. I can't take credit for having found them, and I want to tell you that. But look at that. Image, which is based on Klimt's poster for the an exhibition of what was called the Secession. I don't know if you've learned about that, but that was the radical artist movement in Vienna at the turn of the century. You can see that one Inga Preda turns Klimt's almost quasi-abstract symbolic image into living models depicted, photographed in reality. The whole scene takes on a very almost surreal character. This is my absolute favorite. This is also from the series that Preda did. So above we have Klimt's, the Beethoven frieze, the section of this Beethoven frieze is much longer, called The Hostile Powers to Typhon. It's highly symbolic, almost abstract even, but very, very symbolic, turns into this display of living models as photographed by Inga Preda. And to again bring us full circle, in Preda's Death and Life, the photo Death and Life on the lower part of the screen, we see the reference to Klimt's painting that we started with, Death and Life, and its symbolic connotations. And by the way, you might wonder who those guys are in the lower right or the right-hand side of Preda's image. If you look the two figures, in fact, these two men are models, modern, present-day models, but they represent, guess who, Klimt and Schiele. So thank you very much.